for this evening's Christmas program. In Hillsdale, we're blessed with many musicians that give of themselves, dedicate themselves to serving here, and we appreciate so much our music pastor, Steve Armstrong, as he leads this group. But there are so many others that really make up what is the music of this season. I'm going to invite you to stand with me. You're going to have a word of prayer. And ushers, if you could, go ahead and close the doors in the back. As people come in, they can do so. But let's open this service in prayer. Let me, just one comment. Sometimes you go to places and you don't know, do we clap, do we not clap? And I'm going to ask that you hold your applause all the way to the end. We would like to keep the service going. Part of our worship is not to applaud men, it is to glorify God and worship Him. And I know that's the heart of the musicians tonight. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you for the season. And we are reminded you are the reason for the season. Even though there is so much about the world today that is so different. And Lord, as we contemplate looking back now over 2,000 years, we realize that the world has changed so much, and yet the world has changed so little. We still live in a world that is a world that is troubled, turmoil is everywhere. We live in a world in which we often hear of deaths, sorrows. And even as we gather tonight, we know that as families, there are different ones here, that as we look at the celebration of this holiday, that some of us reflect back at losses, the loss of a loved one, the loss of one's health, the trouble, the trials of COVID, and all that has been a part of this world in the last 2 years. And yet, Lord, I'm reminded tonight, as I remind everyone that is here, that you're still the God who sits on heaven's throne. You're still the King of kings and the Lord of lords. You are the God that has numbered our days, and our times are in thy hand. So, Lord, we're here tonight to celebrate the music of the season, but realizing that the season is regarding you, your birth, your person, the King of kings and the Lord of lords. And so, Lord, take that which is done tonight. Be glorified in it, I pray. I pray that as we listen to the music and as we enjoy the performances of the talent that is represented here, we might realize that you're the God that has given us music, you're the God that has given us talent, you're the God that has given us life, and we worship you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you. Thank you.
Of Jericho. Wow. Okay, so we've got one woman who played the harlot, another woman who was a harlot, and then we come to another, and her name is Ruth. We read here, Salmon begat Boaz of Rahab, and Boaz begat Obed of Ruth. Now, who was Ruth? Ruth was a Moabite woman. She was a woman of idolatrous descent. Her lineage was one of pagan worshipers. And so now we've got, in the lineage of Jesus Christ, Tamar, who played the harlot, Rahab, who was a harlot, Ruth, who was descended from idol-worshipping ancestry. And then we come to another woman. She's the fourth woman in our list here. And her name was Bathsheba. But she's not even named. In fact, Matthew chapter 1 and verse 6, and Jesse begat David the king, and David the king begat Solomon, and doesn't even mention her name. Of her, they have been the wife of Urias. And who was the wife of Urias? Bathsheba. And what did Bathsheba do? She committed adultery with David the king. And so now we have four women of the lineage of Jesus Christ that we would look and say, well, you know, those are women I would go around bragging about. And then we come to Mary. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise. When is his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Now, Mary is a virgin woman, an innocent woman. A woman that you would look at her life and say, well, there had been no scandal at all. She was the one that God had chosen to bear his son, Jesus. And yet she, giving birth to Jesus, was now under a scandal herself, a cloud. The neighbors of the village would all make the assumption that either she was bearing the child of another man or she was bearing the child of Joseph, whom she had not yet married. So there you have it, five skeletons in the closet. And then you come to the overriding one, the very person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Why would God have in his word five women? He could have chosen other women. It surely would have been the scandal of these five. But they were all central to the narrative of God's grace.
Amen.
That's what Christmas is about. Yeah. It's about the grace of God expressed in the birth of his son to a lowly woman named Mary. Conceiving a child of the Holy Ghost. And the one that she conceived in her womb had no sinful background as you and I. We were born of fathers who were born of fathers. We are of a lineage of sinners. And as innocent as you might think your little one is, perhaps in the nursery tonight, I can assure you, give them enough time, you're going to find out they're not so winsome after all. Because that's the nature of us all. Can you imagine Mary raising Jesus? He never sinned. The perfect child. I can imagine growing up as a brother and a sister in that household, that Jesus is the perfect child. And you're the one that is always in trouble, but never cries. You see, he needed to be the sinless one in order that he might be the Savior of the world. All that we're listening to tonight, the beautiful music, the celebration of his birth, but we must remember, he was born to die. His purpose had come. He would not die because of any sin that he had committed, but he died for my sin, and he died for your sins. The perfect Lamb, the sinless one, the holy child, crucified for your sins. Don't celebrate Christmas without taking time to know the Christ of Christmas, the Savior. I want to remind you as we continue tonight on Friday night, which is Christmas Eve, December the 24th, at 6 o'clock, we'll have a traditional candlelight service in here. Some of the musicians you're listening to tonight will be playing, but most of that service will be singing the carols of Christmas. And I invite you, tonight you are a spectator. On Friday night, you will be singing. And I hope that you'll come back. The doors of the church will open about 5:30, and 6 o'clock, our Christmas Eve service begins. By 7 o'clock, we're going to be going back out the door. It's a wonderful place to come. For those that live in the area, you have nowhere else to be. Maybe you have no family. What better place to go on Christmas Eve when all the families are celebrating? You can come here, and there's usually some 300 or more that are here. And don't be alone when you can be with those who love the Lord and those who will love you too. Amen? Let's pray. Lord bless, as we continue, I thank you. I do not know as I look out at this audience, and I realize that there are those that are listening online tonight. And maybe they're doing what all the world does this time of year, celebrating Christmas without knowing the Christ child, the Messiah, the anointed one, the Holy One, Jesus Christ. And thank you that in your sovereign plan, that you set your love upon us, you demonstrated and commended your love to us, and that Christ died for our sins. For that is the meaning of the season. To identify not the baby in the manger, but to identify the one that came. He left the glories of heaven and humbled himself and became a man, a servant who died for us. Thank you, Lord, for the hope that is life eternal.